are just casts. They were made specifically so we could use them to tell this story.
By looking at the skeletal remains, in particular cranial morphology, the size and shape of the skull, there was some indication that some of the people from the graveyard had been of African ancestry. So that was the thing that really keyed us that this could be something very different and important for Albany history.
The skull and mandible of the oldest woman from the site. And you notice how unusual it looks. That's because she had lost all of her teeth before she died. But she was still, this is the woman who still was very robust and was able to continue working. So obviously she was still able to take nutrition, take sustenance.
Wow.
But she, you know, she didn't get a break. She had to keep working.
We first did the analysis and we wanted to get as much information on each person and try to, as much as we could, reconstruct the kind of life they led. So we were able to learn, for example, that many of them worked very hard. So you can see that evidence actually in their bones, that they were, you know, muscular.
For the man, he's the most robust person at the in the population among the burial ground. And things like this crest on the back, this is his femur, his leg bone, just like this. So this crest on the back represents a lot of muscle development. So what happens is your bone responds to repeated mechanical stress and actually will build up in certain areas where the muscles attach. So an area like this indicates that there was a lot of repeated heavy use of those muscles. He also has indications of extreme arthritis. So this is his ulna, which is this bone here. It's your lower arm bone. This is your upper arm bone. And then the ulna articulates here. And the radius goes right next to the ulna. So these two go together like this. And that's how you can turn your wrist. But this joint here has all kinds of extra bone that's grown here in an effort to stabilize the joint. So what happens when you use a joint, when you use your limbs repeatedly and strenuously, is a lot of times the cartilage in the joint can break down, and then the body responds by actually producing extra bone to try to stabilize that joint. So what you see here, and I don't have a good example of a non-arthritic one to show you, but is all this extra bone growth. So he had pretty severe arthritis in his elbow.
Anything like dental cavities or evidence of infection or trauma, and we take all that information and we try to create sort of an osteobiography of each person and then look at the group as a whole and see what we can say about this community, if that's who they really represent.
You can see she's lost a tooth. Most of these individuals had very poor dental health, so they had a lot of cavities. They had lost a lot of teeth, they had abscesses. But then if you look over here, there's this little wear facet here. It's that little circular, that's not the normal shape of the tooth. That's actually wear from where she probably held a pipe in between her teeth. So she would have clenched one of those kaolin pipes, those long white pipes. And the kaolin is a clay that's very abrasive and it will eventually wear your teeth down. So same thing if you grind your teeth or if you eat a lot of gritty food, you'll wear your teeth. So that's what happened here. And you can see in some people where they create a nice big wear facet and then they have to actually move the pipe and they start creating a wear facet somewhere else because they can't keep it clenched tight enough. To do an exhibit of this without the faces, we have documents, we have nails, and we have little brass pins, and that's it. So really the faces are what help us tell the story. We could use some of the casts, I'm sure, but you know, the faces are what people really identify with.